Good morning, Scottsdale Bible Church Online. My name is Ryan Hubner, and I'm your online campus pastor here at SBC. We are so glad that you are joining us here this morning online. So wherever you're tuning in from, whether you're next door to us, out of the state, out of the country, take a moment and say hi to us and everyone else in the chat, because there are people just like you tuning in from all around the world, literally all around the world. There could be some in the UK, in Africa, in North America, South America. There's people everywhere, and so take a moment and just connect with them. Just at the very least, say hi, say something. Jump into one of our chats on Facebook, YouTube, on our website. Just make a connection today deeper than just watching online. So I have a couple of things I want to go over with you today. The first of which is something I haven't said for a while, but we have a feature, something available for us online that other people don't have here, and we have a Calendly link for you. So some of you don't know what Calendly is, but for you to connect with me. So it's really easy on a Sunday morning for you to maybe, like if you're in person, to grab your pastor and to talk with them, to sit with them, to go get coffee with them. But online is kind of hard. So how do you connect with me? How do you find me? Where do you grab coffee with me or sit down with me or have a conversation? Whatever it may be that you're looking to maybe get time with me, we have a link that you can click on it. It shows my calendar and you can put yourself somewhere on my calendar. So that link is now posted in the chat for you to grab, for you to take it. I love to pray with you, sit with you, get to know you, talk with you, just walk life with you. So grab that link and then put yourself on my calendar somewhere. I'd love to see you. And then the second thing is that today is Communion Sunday. And so make sure if you have not already done so, that you go and grab your communion elements and have them ready for when we take communion. Now, we will take communion before the message today, so you don't wanna wait until the message is over to go grab them. Grab them now so that you're not running once Jamie finishes his sermon. So get that ready to go. We are so excited to do communion with you. And something that hit me this morning, we don't think about it a lot. When we partake of communion together online, we are doing so, usually people would do it in like one room together, but we online get to do it with people at the same exact time from all around the world. How much of an honor is that to be able to do that together with one another? So Scott's Bible Church, I hope that sits in you, that sinks in you of how blessed we are to be able to sit here online together, to worship the same God together from different parts of the world every single week, all the time. It's so sweet. SBC Online, we love you so much. We are so excited to worship with you today, spend time with you today, to get to know one another more today, and just to love each other, to be God's church together. So again, if you haven't already, take a moment, say hi to us, make yourself known. We are looking forward to spending time with you today and just enjoying what God's gonna do with his church here online. We love you, SBC, and we'll see you very soon.
Well, good morning, Scottsdale Bible Church. Would you stand together today? We enter into a time of reverence, of awe and wonder, as we stand amazed, one and all, in the presence of our dear Savior, this Jesus, the Nazarene, who came, he died, rose again, so that we may have life and life eternal. Let's sing. I stand amazed in the presence of Jesus the Nazarene, and wonder how he could love me, a sinner condemned me, singing how.
We sing.
right before we go to the communion table, we're going to rehearse together this story of the gospel, the good news of who Jesus is and what he's done for us. Let's sing together.
What gift of grace is Jesus my Redeemer? There is no more for heaven now to give. He is my joy, my righteousness and freedom, my steadfast love, my deep and boundless peace. To this I hold, my hope is only Jesus, for my life is wholly bound to His. Oh, how strange and divine, I can see.
Amen. You may be seated. yet not I, but through Christ in me. That's Galatians, right? That's what we've been learning in Galatians, is that it's not we who work, it's not we who save, it's not we who have righteousness, but Christ who has righteousness, and he gives it to us. So that is why, before we receive the word from Pastor Jamie, we're going to enter into our time of communion now so that we can prepare our hearts to receive from the word of Galatians. It's a beautiful gift that we have each week that we can gather in one name, one faith, one Lord. We can celebrate him together. And communion is one of those moments in the church where we have an individual and communal aspect to it, right? There's the individual moment where it's you and the Lord doing business, but it's also we as a church getting to gather together and to, as one, receive of the elements. So today we're going to tease those apart just a little bit. We're going to have the individual moment now, and the communal element we'll have after service over a meal. We're going to be together and to enjoy one another. But now what we're going to do is, after I'm done, I pray, there's going to be an instrumental song from the orchestra. And during that time, as you're praying with the Lord, receive communion on your own, in your heart, before God. Pray, prepare your heart, and know that as you receive the elements, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And yet we know we don't serve a God who is dead, but one that is alive. And that is why we receive communion, to remind us that he will also come again. And so, church, be blessed in the hearing of the word, that on the night when our Lord Jesus was betrayed, he took the bread, he blessed it. He said, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat of the bread and drink of the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Church, would you pray with me? Yet not I, but through Christ in me, Jesus. That's what we sing. That you paid it all. And all to you we owe. And yet you are gentle and you are kind. And you forgive us of our trespasses because of your blood. Because you died and rose again, we can be free and have relationship with you. And so, Lord, as we receive communion together, individually and as one church, would you be glorified, Jesus? Would we proclaim your name? And it's in that name that we pray. Amen.
So we are in the final stretch of our multi-seasonal look at the New Testament book of Galatians. For more than half a year now, can you believe it? We have been in this book, initially plumbing the depths of the gospel of grace last fall, chapters 1-3, and then beginning this year, we've been looking at chapters 4-6, and this idea of what do we do next now that we are followers of Jesus. And we're in the final stretch because we have three messages to go. And you gotta love the way that the Bible presents truth, because it always ends, almost every book of the Bible, with a grand finale, and Galatians is no different. These three messages are gonna be about how to bear each other's burdens, and then next week, how to reap and sow, and then finally, as a culmination to it all, the book ends with the cross, just in time for Holy Week. And so I'm here to tell you guys today, there's gonna be a great march here at our church, and you're gonna be glad that you prioritize church as we wrap up this book, and then after Easter, move on to the book of Proverbs. So why don't you guys bow with me and let's pray. We got a lot to cover today, but it's gonna be worth it. Why don't you pray with me? Father, I thank you for the worship that we've experienced here at the Shea Worship Center and then at our other campuses. Lord, we pray every week that the worship that we have would prepare our hearts and our minds, not only for the week ahead, but also for the message that we're partaking in right now. So hopefully, Lord, you have softened our hearts and focused our minds upon you amidst all the distractions going on around us, so that we could dial into your truth now. And Father, as we either review some things that we already know, or maybe learn some things we didn't know, or at least some nuances of things that we have already known, God, I pray that you'd help us to be men and women of integrity who take what we know, put it into practice Monday through Saturday, and thus bring glory to you. That's my prayer, and I pray this in Jesus' name, and we all say together, amen. So when I was growing up in the Midwest, my grandmother had a small rustic cabin in northern Michigan on a beautiful inland lake. And when she eventually moved to Florida, she handed the cabin down to her three daughters, one of which was my mother. And so I grew up spending about 3 or 4 weeks every summer at what we called the lake. And if any of you have ever been to a lake house, you know that because there's a lake, there's almost always a dock, this thing that jets out into the water so you can tie your boat to it and also swim off the end of it. And as you can imagine, we spent a lot of time on the dock. Now, you got to remember, I'm old enough. This was the 1960s and the 1970s. And so today, if you were to walk out on a dock, it'd be made of plastic polymers or aluminum or something like that. Back then, they didn't have any of that. Docks were made of wood, and it was made of painted wood. And over time, that paint would start to flake and wear off, and so we'd have to paint the dock about every 4 or 5 years. The only problem is that if you just painted it using regular house latex paint, or worse, oil paint, what would happen when your wet feet hit the dock? You'd slip, and it'd be quite a hazard. The good news is it was back before the days that everybody sued everybody, so it didn't really matter if you slipped and broke something, but you didn't want that anyway. And so I'll never forget, as a little kid, my dad one day was preparing to paint the dock, and he went down to the beach and took this gallon of paint, and then he took a big scoop of sand, and he poured it right into the paint. And he started mixing it in, and I said, "Dad, what are you doing?" He said, "Well, we're gonna make the paint very gritty so that when we paint the dock, you guys won't slip as much." And that gritty paint solved the problem. And when you think about it, gang, this is gonna be germane to where we're going today. Grit works well in a lot of areas of life. If you're a gymnast, you know that that white powder that you put on your hands to hold the bars acts as sort of a gritty substance so that you don't slip. If you've ever worked with cement, some people put grit into cement to make the cement a bit more rugged so that it can hold whatever is going on the cement. Many places in Colorado use dirt and grit in the snow in order to have the tires grab things better. Many hand tools, I looked in my workbench this week, have these gritty handles on them made of a lot of texture so I can hold them better. And then this is probably TMI for some of you, but my wife has one of those gritty pumice stones for her feet. And, you know, when they get the calluses on there and all that, she's not listening today, so I can say that. And And I thought that was a good example. Truly, the list is endless of the ways that we use grit to better our lives. Why? Because here's what we've learned. Grit works. It really does. And so what's the point? Here's the deal. When it comes to how you and I are to love those around us, what you're going to learn today is that God says, add some grit. Add some ingredients that I'm going to give you that can help you get a lot more traction out of loving those around you, especially those who are hurting and in trouble. So as we turn the page into the final chapter of Galatians, chapter 6, here is the main point that we confront in the first five verses of this chapter, and it's this, that we are called to help, not hurt, those who have fallen. I know it seems so simple, but I'm going to show you today, Christians have a lot of growth when it comes to this. We are called to help, not hurt, those who have hit hard times and fallen. So look with me at how the first five verses of Galatians chapter 6 puts this to us. It says, brothers and sisters, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him or her in a spirit of gentleness. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. And then here it is. Bear one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if anyone thinks he is something when he is nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one test his own work, and then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor. For each one will have to bear his own load. So I put it there in yellow here. What the average Christian today who's read the Bible for any length of time associates these five verses with is that often repeated phrase, bear one another's burdens and so fulfill the law of Christ. And one of the things that almost all Bible experts agree on is that when it refers there to the law of Christ, it's referring to Jesus's often repeated command to love each other. He says, love your neighbor as yourself. He said to the disciples, a new commandment I give you, to love one another as I have loved you. And so clearly here, when it says bear one another's burdens and thus fulfill the law of Christ, it's a call to help, not hurt, those who have fallen on hard times. And yet this is just a flyover understanding. This is just a cursory understanding that most Christians should have of this passage. When you look closely, however, at this, you're going to notice at least three precise ways we are to help those who are fallen, three ways that we are to bear one another's burdens, three ways to add some grit to your love and to your bearing of one another in your day-to-day lives, to make it very sticky. And so here's the first one, and that is that this passage tells us to bear boldly, to bear boldly. Now, so look again at verse 1, and don't miss that contained in here is a real-life scenario. This should be practical to you and I, and then it's consummate follow-up of how we should respond. It says, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression, you who are spiritual should restore him in a spirit of gentleness. So we'll get to this in just a second here. It's a real life scenario and then a Christ-like response. Now, before we get to that, I just want to point out in a cursory fashion, this is really important, two words that I think we often overlook here, and it's the word anyone and any. It says, brothers, if anyone is caught in any transgression. Why is that important? Because what it doesn't say is, brothers, if someone that you happen to like and enjoy and have an affinity with is caught in some kind of minor sin that wouldn't take too much for you to get involved in. No, it doesn't say that at all. It says, if anyone in your sphere of influence, anyone is caught in any type of sin, no qualification at all, then here's what you are to do. And so with that understanding, the real life scenario is simply this, that someone is caught in the clutches of sin or they're burdened by difficult circumstances in this sinful world. That word caught there in verse 1 is a very revealing word in the original Greek, and I don't think it means what some of you think it means. It doesn't mean caught in the sense of like, ha, I caught you. like you were trying to hide your sin and I have found you out. That's not what it means at all. No, what this word actually means in the original Greek is to be surprised by sin, to be ensnared by sin. I like how one commentator says it, to be forcibly laid hold of before reflection by your sin. It's caught in the sense of being ensnared or trapped. As Tim Keller says in his commentary, and I quote, it refers to a pattern that has taken hold of a person's life. And I don't know about you, but this tends to describe sin, at least as far as I have experienced it and understand it. As being a pastor now for over 35 years, I've noticed over the years that most people don't sit at the altar and say, I do, and expect a failed marriage. Have you ever noticed that? Most people don't start a business in order to go into financial ruin. I don't know of too many people who decided to become an alcoholic when they took their first drink. I don't know of too many people who intentionally chose to raise messed up kids. Here's the deal, gang. Most of us would look back and realize that when it comes to sin in our lives, it took us off guard. We got a bit over our heads when we entered into some things, and we didn't necessarily intend on things getting out of control. Most of us have been surprised how sin can mess up our lives, and though we're still held responsible for it, we'll see that in a minute here. At the same time, it's simply revealing to us that sin can sneak up on us. We can get caught in it before we even realize it. And then in continuing to describe this real life scenario, it uses that word burden there. So you're not just caught up in sin, but it becomes a burden. Again, very pictorial in the original language. It's the Greek word baros, and it literally means, now don't miss this, a tremendous weight, a very heavy load. It was used by the Greeks and Romans, this word in Jesus' time, you gotta love this, to refer to the absolute tipping point of a scale, where the scale became so heavy, it tipped so to one side that it was just overwhelming. You can picture that. And so it could be referring to very difficult circumstances that simply hit us in a fallen, sinful world. Or, as verse 1 suggests, it could be referring to our own sin that takes us off guard and surprises us. But either way, it's the burden of sin, either sinful circumstances or sin by our own choice, and it's a burden. It's like the high end of a scale. It's the tipping point that becomes too overwhelming for even the most rugged of us. That's what it's saying here. This is the real life scenario that many people get into. And it's right at this point, here in verse 1, that it then gives us the Christ-like response that you and I should have. Again, remembering anyone caught in any circumstance like this, what does it say? It says, and I quote, you who are spiritual should restore in a spirit of gentleness. Now, I gotta tell you, gang, I love the precise words that it uses here. Simply put, those of us who are spiritual. It sounds awfully sanctimonious, if you ask me, but when you look at the word, it's actually simply the word pneumatikos, that simply means those of us who happen to be doing well right now in our walk with Jesus. Simply means those of us who are rather centered right now. We're doing okay spiritually. So those of you, those of us who are in that place, are called to restore by coming alongside the other person. That word restore simply means to set right, to bring back to the original condition. It's used in Matthew 4 to refer to the fixing or mending of a broken fishing net. And we do this by bearing another person's burden. Again, a very powerful word, the word bear, and we'll talk about this more in a minute here, simply means to carry some of the load. Interestingly, it's the exact same word used in John 19, in which it says Jesus bore his own cross as he carried it to Golgotha. And it's saying that you and I, when we're spiritual, need to come alongside those who are beat up and do that for them. And then we'll talk about this more in a second here. We're supposed to do so in a spirit of gentleness. I want your whistle here, as one commentator says, over and against a judgmental spirit. So don't miss this. It's a powerful call to bear boldly, simply calling you and I to put our strength where somebody else's struggle is happening, to put our wisdom where somebody else's confusion is winning the day, to put our gentle love in place of somebody else's strong sin. And if you're still wondering what all this means on a practical level, look at how the late Tim Keller says it in his wonderful little commentary on Galatians. This is good. He says, you cannot help with a burden unless you come very close to the burdened person. Standing virtually in their shoes and putting your own strength under the burden so its weight is distributed on both of you, lightening the load of the other. So in the same way, a Christian must listen and understand and then physically, emotionally, spiritually take up some of the burden with the other person. I like that. I like how he's trying to bring it home to you and I from these lofty theological concepts to what you and I need to do every day when we have people, and we do have people in our lives who are overburdened with the things around them. As I've thought about this over the years, both with what this passage is saying as well as what Keller is suggesting, I would state it this way, that there's three things you and I are called to do in order to bear boldly. We're called to listen, we're called to help, and we're called to pray. If you ever wondered what God wants you to do for those around you right now who are overweighted with either their own sin or the sin of this world, you are called to listen, help, and pray. You're called first to listen. James 1:19 couldn't be more clear. Let us be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to become angry. Because you see, many times what the burdened person needs more than anything else is simply to tell you their story, to have a shoulder and an ear that they can tell their story to and cry upon. And then once you've listened, they need your help. And I mean tangible help. You simply asking the question, what can I do to lighten your load? What can I take for you? Most Christians talk a big game here. We just don't deliver very well. And then you're to pray. Don't overlook this one. People sometimes tell me, and I really appreciate when they do, they tell me, Jamie, I pray for you every day in your ministry. And you know what I always say? I say only heaven will reveal how powerful that really is. I might not feel it all the time right now, but I think someday in heaven, God's gonna say, Jamie, you were only sustained by the prayer of these people. And that's true for those who are burdened around you as well. You see, here's what I know. If you and I, as followers of Jesus, would just do these three simple things consistently with the beat up ones around us, listen, help, pray, listen, help, pray, there'd be no stopping us when it comes to what we can do to make a dent of love in the world around us, especially those that we care about. And again, I know what some of you are thinking. You're saying, well, Jamie, these are pretty simple things. I mean, don't we do these all the time? I'm glad you asked. No, we don't do these things all the time. That's my simple point. In fact, I don't mean to step on some of your toes or beat you up too much, but let me share with you what I have observed both in me as well as in many well-meaning Christ followers when it comes to these three things. Here's what I observe too many of us do. First, we listen. We listen enough to get the gist of it, which usually is about 2 to 3 minutes, and then we move on to the second thing, right? I mean, we've been around the block 1,000 times. We've heard these stories 1,000 times, these tales of woe. So somebody will start telling me their tale of woe. I'm like, yeah, okay, yeah, I know. I can tell you the same story. Why don't you stop talking and let me help you? That's the way I many times tend to think. And that, again, for a quick learn like me, it takes about 2 to 4 minutes, if I'm in a good mode, for me to listen to you. And I see a lot of Christians do that. And then what we do is we move on to the second step right away. And you know what our help looks like? Tell me if this isn't true. We help those by instructing them to the point of lecturing them. Have you ever noticed that? In fact, these are the opening words that I hear many Christians use when they're dealing with hurting people. Three words I hear right away is, have you tried? So we listen for 2 minutes and say, hey, Rich, have you tried this? Have you tried that? Have you tried? As if this guy's an idiot and hasn't tried those things already. And then the other words, even more dangerous, that I hear Christians say, and I've had these used on me, a lot of times they'll say, well, let me tell you where you went wrong, Pastor. I hear that a lot. I'll give my tale of woe to somebody and they'll say, well, you know, okay, let me tell you what you did. And again, I'm not an idiot. I know what I did. the reason I'm coming to you is because I've been caught and snared, either in my own sin or the sin of the world around me, and I'm stuck. I don't need a lecture. I don't need you to tell me where I went wrong. No, I need you to truly listen to me. Let me unpack it in front of you. And most people don't listen very well. Let me tell my story to you. Listen for more than 2 to 4 minutes. And then when you help, offer me something substantive, something that will truly take the burden off of me. And then we say, well, I'll pray for you, which is code for, if I think about it and feel like it, I'll pray for you. How many of us truly commit to praying for those that we're trying to help? And I mean every day, each moment of the day. I'm gonna share with you in a few minutes here something happened to me about a week ago and why I wasn't in the pulpit last week. Nothing terrible, but just why I was out of the pulpit. I wasn't supposed to be out last week. And I have some close friends in my life who know what's going on in my life. And one guy every morning just sent me, you know, one of those emoticons and how one of them are the praying hands? He just sent me every morning an emoticon with praying hands saying, I'm praying for you. And initially I responded, you know, thanks and appreciate it. And finally he said, stop responding. I just need you to know that you're on my prayer radar and I'm praying for you regularly. How many of us really do that? You see, I'm telling you, if we could learn to listen, if we could learn to help, if we could learn to pray, like adding sand to the paint that we're painting in our lives, it adds a lot of grit. And before you know it, we're bearing boldly. Now, a little more quickly, notice me a second rather precise way this passage tells us we should bear one another's burdens. And because of the third one, we're gonna blow through this one kind of fast, but it is very important. And that is that the text tells us to bear carefully. It tells us to bear carefully. So isn't it interesting when it's telling us that we need to help restore someone who has fallen, look at what it says right away. It says, but keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. Keep watch on yourself, lest you too be tempted. So simply put, it's telling us that as we help others, as we enter in richly into their problems and lives, watch your own soul so that you, one, either don't fall into the same trap or just get influenced negatively by all the crud going on in their lives. And I know how some of you are thinking right now. You're thinking, well, that doesn't really happen too often, does it? What's the answer to that? Yeah, it happens a lot. Again, I've been a pastor for 35 years, and I'm telling you, this is good advice to heed. I've seen those who are alcoholics or drug addicts who have gotten sober and clean only to fall off the wagon as they tried to help others who are struggling. I've seen business people come along, other people who are in business and are struggling and failing, and they enter into their failed business only to get in trouble themselves financially in their lives. And again, I'm not suggesting, neither is the text here, that we should not help somebody. The call is obviously to help them. It's just saying that as you do, be careful you don't get too mired in their own issues. Keep your head on as you're trying to help them. So you know who modeled this perfectly? Say his name with me. It's not Jamie, it's Jesus. Jesus is the one who modeled this perfectly. Thank you, somebody yelled it out here. It's Jesus who modeled this perfectly. And how did Jesus model this? Look at the life of Jesus. He hung around tax collectors and sinners all the time, didn't he? I mean, that's why the religious leaders hated him, because he was at these places hanging around Matthew at his tax collector's booth and all the harlots and those who were steeped in sin. I mean, he was hanging around them, but what's interesting is that he never engaged in sin with them. So he didn't actually collect taxes with Matthew. He didn't go down to the temple cults as they were engaged in prostitution. No, he hung around sinners, but he didn't engage in the sin. And I think that's all this passage is saying here, that as you are involved in people whose lives are a mess and who are struggling, keep watch on yourself so that you don't get tempted as well. It's a good, gritty warning that it's giving us. So we're to bear boldly, we're to bear carefully. And then this naturally leads to the third precise way, we're to bear one another's burdens. And this is actually going to help you bear more boldly and more carefully. And it's my favorite of the three, and that is to bear humbly. To bear humbly. So look one last time at our passage and notice how it tells us we need to bear. These are great words, verses 3-5. For if anyone thinks he is something when he's actually nothing, he deceives himself. But let each one test his own work, and then his reason to boast will be in himself alone and not in his neighbor. For each one will have to bear his own load. Now, I baited you a second ago and said these are great words. They are great words, but they deserve a little bit of explanation because at face value, it seems, if you're paying attention here, like there's one massive contradiction going on here. And the contradiction is in verse 2, it says, bear one another's burdens. And yet in verse 5, and I put it there in yellow, it says, bear your own load. And if you're paying attention at all, you got to ask the question, well, which is it, Paul? I mean, are we to bear each other's burdens or are we to carry our own load? I mean, you seem to be doing double speak here. So which is it? And the answer is found not in the word bear, because it does use that word twice in verse 2 and verse 5. It says bear another's burdens, bear your own load. The answer is found in the two different words, and the English translation actually catches this. It's two different Greek words for burden versus load. So verse 2 says, bear one another's burdens. And as you and I have seen, that's that word that's the tipping point of the scale. It's a weight too great for you to handle. It's an overwhelming weight. That's what that word burden means. That happens in life. Interestingly, in verse 5, the word load here is best translated. Now watch this, as one Bible expert says, as a proper burden, a normal load to carry. Or as one commentator says, I love this. He says it's the difference between a heavy burden versus a backpack. See, we all have backpacks. But if your backpack is too weighted down, if it's filled with rocks and a bunch of things like that, it's going to crush you. And so what it's saying here, now don't miss this, is that when you and I are spiritually strong and we're helping those who are overly burdened, it's only because God, in his great sovereignty and care, has seen fit to bless you in this season of your life with a proper burden, a manageable load to carry at this point, not so weighty that it's crushing you. And because of this, this should in and of itself cause you to remember that it's only by the grace of God that you're not overwhelmed right now. Because at the end of the day, you're really nothing when you think you're something. It's only God who has blessed you right now with your lot in life, and you should be humble because of this. That outside of the grace of God, we all truly are nothing, verse 3. And if we're tempted to think that we're something, we're deceiving ourselves, reading our own press releases too much. And here's the deal, gang, when you actually apply this to your own life, when you realize that you have a proper load to carry at this point, and it's only because of God's grace that you're actually nothing without him, I'm telling you, it works. This causes in you, it creates in you a humility that when you then go to help other people, they sense this humility in you. They sense this non-judgmental spirit in them, and they go like this when you offer your help. But conversely, if you come to them, as so many Christians do, thinking that you're all that, thinking that you're something, thinking that you are what you are because you've worked hard and you've made something of your lives and these people are a pitiful mess because they've screwed up. If that's your mindset in coming to them, they're gonna smell that a mile away, amen? And they're gonna go like this, and they're not gonna wanna receive your help, which is why Paul spends 3, 4, 5, these three verses here trying to hammer home to us that humility is the best way to bear somebody else's burden. I told you I was gonna tell you why I was out last week. It wasn't a big deal, but I don't wanna be like the Secretary of Defense and, you know, go off the radar here and not tell you guys why. And not picking on the guy, but that was a mistake. And so I'm not your Secretary of Defense. Well, I kind of am. So last week I had another small surgery on my other surgery on my prostate. There was some scar tissue they had to deal with, and so it just took me out for another week. Good news is I'm fine, much quicker recovery here, and I'm back, but I had to be out for about 10 days as I was recovering. Yeah, I guess you can clap at that. Believe me, no one's happier than me. So that's good. So anyways, I was out last week, and I did have to spend one night in the hospital. I hardly am ever in the hospital, but I was in the hospital overnight, again, about 10 days ago. And, you know, when you're in the hospital just for one night, rightly so, there aren't too many people that visit you. There shouldn't be. And so the main people you interact with are the nurses. And I'm a fairly social guy, so as I was recovering there, you know, I'm thanking the nurses and getting to know them a little bit. And I'll never forget the morning nurse when she came on. You know, after a few minutes of conversation, they always ask the same thing, and that's, what do you do? And I love that question because it's a great segue into, you know, what I do. And I say, well, I'm a pastor, and I pastor a church. And, you know, how'd you get into that? And, well, I didn't plan on it. I just fell in love with Jesus, and now I want to help other people fall in love with Jesus. And this one nurse was great. She said, yeah. And gang, I hear this all the time. I hear this way too often in today's world. She said, yeah, I used to go to church. I was raised in the church. And I said, well, it sounds like you don't go now. She goes, nah, not so much. And I said, well, tell me more. By the way, three of the most powerful words. Instead of saying, have you tried, why don't you say to people, tell me more? Because it's a great way to listen. So I said to her, tell me more. It didn't take much prodding. And she told me a wonderful story. She said, I was raised in a very conservative, wonderful church. My mom is still alive. I talk to her every day. We have a great relationship. So do my kids with her. She's super religious. She said, but I just couldn't deal with all the attitude. And I said, tell me more. She said, well, you know, when it comes to all these issues that everybody's all upset about today, she said, you know, I don't agree with my mom on everything there, but it was less about the disagreement and more just about all the judgmentalism that I sensed from her and all the fellow churchgoers. I said, tell me more. And she said, well, and she started to tell me some of the content of the issues, you know, sexual identity, abortion, things like that. And I said, tell me more. Tell me what your views are on this. And she started telling me. And I said to her at one point, I said, I know you have some views that differ from your mom, but they're really not too different from them. I mean, I think you guys are much closer than you think. She says, we actually are. She said, but my mom can't really take that. And all she does is harp on me and the world around her. And it hit me as this dear nurse was talking that it really wasn't as much about the content as much as it was about the attitude. That what turned her off to church people, and again, she loved her mom. She was very respectful of her mom. But what kind of turned her off there was how she approached the issues, not necessarily the content of the issues, though there was some of that. And as I said to her probably four or five times, tell me more, tell me more, tell me more, I got to believe that that was a positive conversation for her. That she hadn't talked to too many pastors that were willing to listen and then to just listen and listen and listen and interject a couple times and say things like, well, you're not really too far off and it sounds like it was more the attitude and what have you. And before I know it, she was really processing a lot of that. And I finally slipped in one good instructional moment. I'm always good for that. And it wasn't judgmental. I simply said to her, you know, I hang around church people a lot, and I agree with you. There are some that are like that, but there's an awful lot that aren't. There's an awful lot that have been broken and humbled in their own lives. And I think if you had conversations with them, like with me, you're going to find that it's really not all over the place. And she said, thank you. She didn't fall down and call me blessed. She didn't say she was going to come to our church or anything like that. But I think it was a good conversation. And maybe I helped a little bit to restore this gal to maybe a believing community again. The call that you and I have today, and we need to walk out of here with this, is to help, not hurt, those who have fallen, to bear one another's burdens. And how do we do this? How do we add some sand, some grit to this call? We bear boldly, entering in such a way that we listen, we tangibly help, and we pray. We bear carefully, watching our own soul to not get sucked in as well, because that's not going to help anybody. And we bear humbly, remembering that there, but for the grace of God, go I. That God has blessed us now with a proper load, but that's only because of his grace. And when you and I do this, I truly believe we're going to have more opportunities to help those who have fallen and are struggling around us. One closing story, and then we're done. There's a guy in a church here that I have just fallen in love with. and he's 90 years old. He's one of the oldest saints in our church, and he's just a dear, sweet older man. His name is Ken. Some of you might have met him, Ken Sanders. Ken's been in our church for, I don't know, like since Jesus walked this earth. I mean, it's been a very long time. I mean, Ken's been in his church for decades and decades and decades. And at one time, Ken, and he'll tell you about this if you ask him, was one of the top architects or designers of churches literally in the nation. He helped all the big guys back in the day design church buildings. And you know people like this. Sometimes people retire from what they do and they stop talking about it. And then there's other people that never really retire from it and they never stop talking about it. That's Ken. He can talk about church buildings and the design of them and his vision for them. At 90, he's still acting like he's 20. And I've said for a long time that one of the most dangerous tools seniors have is a computer and email, because what they do a lot is that they sit at home and they're on their computer and email, and because they're not employed anymore, they just read a lot and they send a lot. And so I get an email from Ken literally every day. And here's what you need to know. My assistant and I save every one of them. I actually have a subfolder called KS in my Outlook, Ken Sanders, and I put everyone in them, some of them that I don't even read. I just put in them there because, again, he's very ubiquitous. He sends out a lot of emails. But most of them I do read because, again, I love this man and I respect him and how he loves Jesus and what he's done for churches over the years. This week, he sent me another email, got a few of them, and this one was called Finding Reality. And that kind of hit me. I thought, wonder what he's trying to say there. And they're always pretty pithy. And he said this, and this moved me. Maybe it'll move you. He said, the design responsibility of an architectural designer is finding the reality taking place in the architecture for the church life. He says, visiting the SBC campuses, I found every space filled with all seasons of life, meaning old and young, and everyone was enjoying their reality time together. And I thought, well, what does he mean by reality time? And he answers it. He says, what I really experienced seeing was the love reality taking place. He says, this kind of reality foundation is the kind you've been teaching, Jamie. Love, Ken. And I thought, wow, what a wise man. To not see church, even though he designed most of these churches, as just a building, but a building that has a purpose. Now, obviously, Ken would say the purpose is to lift up Jesus and worship Jesus. He sends me emails on that. But on this particular day, he was focusing on the second great commandment, and that's to love one another. And he tied it to reality, that the reality that's occurring here and at all of our campuses, that should be occurring everywhere, is a love reality. And more importantly, this 90-year-old guy walks on these campuses and he feels it. He senses it. I'd like to believe it's because you and I are learning to bear one another's burdens. There's a lot of pain and hurt that walks into these doors every day of every week. And I have to remember myself to bear boldly, to listen for more than 2 to 4 minutes, and to help in any way that I can, and to pray every moment of every day for those that come to me, and then to bear carefully, and mostly to bear humbly, because the arrogance isn't gonna help anybody, but the humility that was displayed in our Savior certainly will. You guys can do that, and we can create a love reality. Let's pray. Father, I know for many of us here today, we are thinking of current individuals in our lives who right now are burdened beyond excess. And Lord, some of them brought it on themselves. That's what this text is saying. We sin, we deal with sin in our lives, and it overwhelms us. Lord, some of them, though, are just dealing with other people's sin and the sin of the society and culture in this world, and it's overwhelming them as well. But it doesn't matter. The text doesn't really make a distinction there. It just says that they're burdened. We know people like that, Lord. And so, God, I hope today that we can walk out of here with a renewed faith, a renewed desire to love them, whether it's our kid or our spouse or a friend or a coworker or a fellow church member. And that, Lord, we might be one this week who can bear boldly, who can bear carefully, and bear humbly. By your Spirit, help us to do that. And may we restore as a result of that. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Well, church, what a great moment for us to go and have a meal together. We get to go and love one another well. We get to go and listen to each other, to help one another, to pray for one another as we go enjoy some food together this Communion Sunday. I hope you were encouraged and transformed by the Word of God as I know I was. As you go as well, one thing to note, next Sunday, get ready, we're gonna have some announcements about our Tanzania project. So just get ready to come and hear some fun updates and some good moments that you can jump into that. With all that said, we'll be up here after service for prayer. I'll see you out though on the patio. We love you guys. We'll see you next week.
Well, Scottsdale Bible Church Online, thank you so much for being here today with us. We hope that message was just encouraging for you and just restorative for you as you go out into your spheres of influence. And it just taught you more of what it looks like to follow Jesus Christ and to care for those who have fallen or who are broken or who are hurting. These are such important things for us as followers of Christ. So before you go, two things. One, just a reminder of our Connect with Pastor link. If you are wanting to connect with me, pray with me, sit with me, I'd love to meet you, just get to know you as our online congregation. You can just click on the link in any of our chats and you can put yourself on my calendar. I would love to be with you. And then second thing, if you need prayer right now, we are here to pray with you. Go to scottsdalebible.com/live prayer, and we are here to pray with you, pray for you, talk with you. We are here as your church for you. So we love you, SBC. Have an amazing day, and we'll see you very soon.